I just want to focus on this particular team, which is graph signal processing and graph machine learning. So I don't know if you know a lot about this kind of graph structure, so I will start very slowly, maybe too slow, I don't know. So if I see that you your face are like doing some strange have some straight attitude, then I will go slower. You can also ask questions. Don't hesitate to answer me. So when I want to do some graph signal processing or graph machine learning, that means I have some data where inside the data you have a graph or network that are this kind of structure are just nodes that are connected together. So you can think about, for example, a transportation network where you have roads connected, energy network, power lines. You can also think about a social network where you have users that are friends, are connected because they are friends or that because they share or retweet something. You have also some biological networks. You could have also a network of atoms, what is called a molecule, and also meshes and grids, so that you have a point cloud and then you just connect the closest neighbors. But it's not only that in the data, you have a graph, but you also have some data attached to the nodes or the edge of the graph. So that means you have some kind of, for example, activity. Here you have like maybe a traffic jam, and then you have a lot of cars on these roads. So you have a high signal here, high value. You have a higher degree of activity for the for some users. They retweet a lot or share a lot. And then you could have also some feature vector, for example, for the atoms. You have the property of each atom. That could be the data. You could also have time series attached to the node, like activity of the brain, for example. So we have a graph and additionally some data on the, mainly I will focus on the node for this talk, but you can have also on the edges. And the thing is, the idea with the graph is that the nodes, if they are connected, that means there is some kind of affinity or similarity. So you want to take advantage of that and take this information and combine it to the data to extract some information. Okay, so extracting some information, what does it mean? It's so a few typical use of this this topic. If you just have a graph, for example, without any data, you could maybe try to see if there are some clusters. So nodes that are more connected together than with the rest. Then you want to separate and classify in communities. You could have some application like this, where you have a graph, you have some data on some of the nodes, but then you want to propagate these values because on these nodes, the value is missing, you want to guess it. And you know that if it's connected, it's similar, so it should have a similar value. So you can just propagate or smooth this value all over the graph. Or you could have also many values, but they are noisy. And you know that you could maybe average noise because if neighbors are connected, that means they should have a similar value. Okay. And you have also another thing which is even more maybe complex, it's to try to detect patterns. So particular shapes that are, that would exist on the graph and that you could use a graph convolutional neural network, for example. Like for images, but for on the graph instead of a regular grid. So we have a graph, but then how do you encode it to do some machine learning on it? This is very simple. So you can just describe it in mathematical terms. So here is just a simple graph with three nodes and two connections. So you have this set of nodes, okay? Vertices are also called, and then connection edges. And you can introduce this adjacency matrix. It's just a matrix where you have zero if a node is not connected and one if it's connected. So for example, for this column, it's node V1. it's zero for connection reveal. There is no self connection. It's not so useful here. So zero, then one because it's connected to V2, and zero because it's not connected to V2. Okay, and V2 is connected to V1 and V3, so it's connected to V1 and V3. And then this object describes your graph. Very good. So it's a matrix. So you can build tensor and apply TensorFlow if you want. And all you need is this kind of object. So I could just stop here because now you know how to use a graph with neural networks. But let's go a little bit further. You can have also some graphs. Most of them, they are three-way. So instead of having just connected, not connected, you can have a strength on the connection. And instead of the one, you replace by a weight, which is positive. And the higher the weight, that means the strongest the connection, okay? Because zero is no connection. Just to introduce, just before I go to the next slide, the degree of a node. So the degree is just the sum of connection. And in case of weight, it's just the sum of weight on the connection of the node. Yes. You could have a graph which is directed. That means instead of having just connection, you have some arrows. So that means you have a connection that goes in one direction, but not the other. And in that case, the weight 1, 2, and 2, 1 are different. But then this is a bit annoying because you don't have a symmetric matrix, and we'll see why it's annoying just after. So for this talk, I'll just focus on symmetric matrices. So we'll just forget about directed graph and focus on the undirected ones. So an example of graph, very simple. Line graph, so three nodes, which is, in fact, you can see it as it's time series because you can have one value for at each node. And the connections means they are just consecutive in time. So it could be a delta of time here. Okay. And it's better like this. So you have a value for each node. Okay. So this is like a function in 1D. And same for an image where you have a grid. And these are the pixels, and you have a value of the free value for each pixel. And that are connected to the four neighbors next to them. So you can just imagine that graph is a generalization of 1D time series and 2D images. So you have this weight matrix that we have seen, plus a vector, which is the same dimension because it's this is the number of nodes. This is the value on the nodes. So you see that you could maybe at some point multiply each other and do some calculation. Okay, so now we have seen, okay, we have a lot of powerful tools. You know, coming from signal processing to apply on time series and on images, a lot of things. Then the question is, can we generalize them on the graph? What are the properties? Do they keep the same properties? And this is a question I will just talk about in this talk. So for example, Fourier transform, what does it become on the graph? Wavelets, does it exist? Can you do some filtering like you do on a 1D time series, for example? And of course, it's signal processing, but then you can also see that connection with machine learning because when you just apply some transformation to the data, that means you, for example, filtering, that means you know something about the data. There is information in some bound, and then there's noise in another bound. So you have putting some inductive bias for the network so that he learns faster, okay? So if you don't like too much signal processing, then just think that we are doing some inductive bias. So now the first step when you do this analysis of data on graph is first, if you have some data, you just look at the values. But then the next step is looking at the difference between the values, because you want to see if there is like an increase or a decrease or something, or some tendency. So what you could do is to introduce a gradient on a signal on a graph, okay? So that would be for a path graph, for example, for a time series, it's just the next value of the function minus value at the point, and divided by a delta that could be like the delta in time. So this can be easily generated on the graph, because you've got the difference between the nodes that are connected. So you take two nodes, I and J, that are connected, you take the difference and you multiply by the weight. Okay, because this is, if delta is zero, that means the delta in time is very small, that means the sampling is very fast, so they kind of should look very similar. And for graph, the weight, when it's small, that means it's way disconnected. So when you have this small delta in time, its weight is just the inverse of it. Okay. Then, okay, this is interesting, but what you see is that when you do that, you have a value which is attached to a node, because it's I and J, so it's not a node, H, sorry. I and J means H between I and J. So when you do the gradient, you have values that are not on the node, that they are on the edges. That's a bit annoying. In standard signal processing, you cheat a little bit, because you assume that you are on the ring, or you have some boundary condition that you just deal with the start and the end, so that when you do the difference, you just put them on the nodes. And in the case of the graph, you cannot do that. So this gradient, just take all the difference and start from the space of nodes and send you to the space of edges, which is not the same dimension. So it's not going to be a symmetric matrix. And it's a bit annoying because you change space. So what you can do is, instead of looking at the first derivative, you can look at the second one. So and this is called the Laplacian. So you take these differences on the edges, and then you compute the differences between these differences, and this gives you a value for the node in the middle. So that maybe yes, okay. So this is one difference minus the other difference here. And I just change the sign here and switch here. And that give me this, which is in fact the expression of the Laplacian on the graph. So you sum over, these are the nodes that are neighbors of the node E. Okay, and I take all the differences, I sum them, and I weight them with the weight of the connection. And this, take value from the node and give me a value for the node. So very good. Now I have a nice, I can just encode it as a nice matrix, which is in fact the degree matrix, so the matrix full of zero, except on the diagonal where you have the degree of the node, and minus the weight matrix that we have seen. Okay, you can apply this to the function. Then it gives you the Laplacian. Since we are on the graph, it's a special space, so you can also have other definition for the Laplacian. For example, you have this one, the random walk Laplacian, so you have to normalize the weight by the degree, because if you're on a node, you want to jump, to have a probability to jump to another node, and then the probability has to sum to one, so you have to just divide by the degree. But then if you do that, you don't have a symmetric matrix. So we won't look at this now. You can have a modified version where you have it's kind of normalized, not the same normalization, but then it's symmetrized. So you get a symmetric matrix with this normalized Laplacian. And of course, if you have a directed graph, you can also use this definition, but it's not symmetric. So we'll focus on this one. Okay, so what are the properties of this Laplacian matrix that are doing this generalization of second derivative on the graph? You can diagonalize it, okay? And you have a set of eigenvalues that are non-negative. And you have a special also property. The first eigenvalue is zero because, and then the eigenvector is the constant. So all ones are one over n on the network. So of course, because it's this is a sort of second derivative. So if there is no variation, it gives you zero. And then you have the other eigenvalues are positive and just increasing. Okay. Two examples of diagonalization of the Laplacian. If you have a path graph, so that means you have just nodes, and then this one is just connected to only one, and the one at the end also. So this is a matrix. The Laplacian matrix is the degree matrix, all have degree two, except the first and the last, and then they are connected, okay, to the following and the previous one. And this you can just compute the eigenvalue. It's an analytic formula, and the eigenvector also, which are the cosine. You see, so it's in fact when you diagonalize this Laplacian, you get the discrete cosine transform. Okay, you can do the same if you have a ring graph. So you just take the two first and last node that you connect together. I mean, you just add this, and again, you can compute the eigenvector. And there are the cosine and sine. And in fact, it's a discrete Fourier transform that you get. So, okay. Now, it's a good fit for us because we want to know what is, for example, the Fourier transform on a graph. So we have two examples of simple graph, and we get what is standard in signal processing, the discrete Fourier transform. Or cosine transform. So now I want to just, of course, when you are on a graph, you won't have this nice cosine because the graph is very irregular, but we would like to know what we keep, what property we keep from the Fourier transform. And you have to think that this, so this Laplacian is giving you an idea of how the function varies, if it varies a lot or not. So, for the Fourier transform, it's the same thing because you the first eigenvector is a constant, same as the graph Laplacian, so no variation. Then the second one, it should be as smooth as possible, but it should also must be orthogonal to the constant. Okay, so that's an eigenvector that will change sign at some point. It has to because this term has to be zero, for example, for if x is a constant. And the solution is, in that case, it's a cosine, okay? And now, and the next eigenvector will be as smooth as possible, but orthogonal to the constant and this one. And this will be an eigenvector that just change sign four times, okay? As it goes on. So, this would be true for a graph too, okay? We'll have this idea of smoothness and of changing sign, but we will lose this nice cosine representation, of course. So example, if you take the eigenvector of the Laplacian, so the first one is a constant, the second one, it has a special name in graph theory, it's called the field vector. It changes sign once on the graph, and it changes its sign where there is it's less the less costly to change sign. So where you have less connection, so here when where you have a bottleneck. So in this case, blue is a sign plus, for example, and red is a sign minus. And then you can just get the graph in two parts, with just by looking at this eigenvector. A few examples on this not so irregular graph, okay? It's just a 2D connection. So it's not too bad. Then the constant, the first eigenvector change sign. So the red is positive, I think, and blue is negative. So it's just somewhere in the middle where there is this bottleneck. Then the next one is also change sign. So if you imagine an image and you take the Fourier transform, the first eigenvector, non-zero eigenvector will be, for example, change sign from up to down, and the second one will change sign from left to right, for example. So this is kind of something like this here, but with deformation. Then you have a next one, which is change sign two times, etc. So but what you see is that it's not a cosine, but it just keeps this idea of smoothness, okay? And it has value everywhere on the network. It's not localized, and it's smooth. And it will be important later on. I think you know that when you have this Fourier transform, the normal one, you know that if a signal is very concentrated or peaky, then the Fourier transform will be very spread. And reversely, if the Fourier transform is very peaky, then the signal will be spread on the domain, okay? And this is the same for the graph. For, it depends, we'll see, it depends on the graph. So what is beautiful with this approach of graph Fourier transform is that now you have the signal defined on the graph. You can do the Fourier transform by diagonalizing your Laplacian, taking the, this is a matrix of eigenvectors. This is like a diagonal matrix with the eigenvalues, okay? So you just apply this, you project your signal on the eigenvectors, and it gives you a sort of graph Fourier transform of your signal. And you can plot it on this frequency domain. It's not frequency anymore because it's not cosine that are just oscillating, but it has this idea of slow variation when it's the lambda, the eigenvalue is small, and high variation when it's lambda is increasing. And when here it's a line, of course, since it's a graph, you have discrete eigenvalues and they are not spaced regularly. So you could have it's an irregular sampling, but it's on a line. So you could, what you can do is to define a function, a 1D function continuously, and then take value for this function, discretize it on the eigenvalue of the Laplacian. And then it define you a function in this graph Fourier space. You can take the inverse Fourier transform, graph Fourier transform, and then you get a function on the graph. And if you just take this function, define it as a filter, for example, I want a bandpass filter where you have I want my function to be the low frequency does not exist, and then I don't want too much high frequency too. Then you define this, and whatever graph you take, it will have eigenvalues. You just discretize the value, and then you create this function on the graph, but independently of the graph. You can have any graph you want. And it will give you a function associated to this value. So you can, if you define some function in the Fourier domain, then it's just general and doesn't depend on the graph. So you can generalize this kind of approach. So you can define filter banks. And that leads me to the next step where you, in this wavelet theory, you know that you can define the wavelet in the Fourier domain. And in fact, what I showed you before, it's there are some wavelets defined in this graph Fourier domain. And what you realize, I don't know if you see it, yeah. So you take the wavelet, you localize it on some point, somewhere in your graph. And then you look at the spreading, and this one has a large spreading, and it goes smaller and smaller. I think you know what wavelets they are made from a Moser wavelet, and then you dilate it or shrink it, and you can project your signal on it, and you have guarantees that you don't lose information. when you do that. So yeah, the same. So you generate your wavelets, and they have deleted or shrunken version of one wavelet, mother wavelet. But of course, it's not very regular. So the spreading is not the same in all the directions. And what you see is that for this one, very well spread on the graph domain, it corresponds to this very narrow function in the graph Fourier domain. And then this one here, very well spread, corresponds to something very picky in the graph domain. Okay. Yeah. So just for you, Shujian, this is a measure of the spreading, which is called entropy, that Shujian is using a lot. You can measure the spreading of a function on the Fourier domain and on the graph domain by just using this entropy. So if the entropy is small, that means your function will be very picky. And if it's big, it's like it's well spread. And you have this relationship, one for entropies, that is called uncertainty principle, that say that if you have a function that is well, the sum of entropies of the function and its Fourier transform or graph Fourier transform here have to be larger than some value. That means if you have something very picky on the domain, then on the other domain, it cannot be also very concentrated and local. Okay. But this bound is depending on something which are this. So this is a canonical basis on the graph. So it's just the delta on the graph. And these are the graph Fourier modes. Okay, so now this will be, if you get this close to one, this will be zero. And this is bad because the bound disappear. You don't have this anymore, this uncertainty principle. Well, why it's bad, we'll see just after. So when is it that you have this configuration? So is it possible? For graph and for which graph is it possible? So if you remember the standard case with the Fourier cosine or sine, they are very well spread. And if you do that, they are not at all similar to a delta. So this is good. This is giving a large bar. Okay, so I just don't need to talk about it. Maybe if there is a question. Now, the question is, what is the shape of these Fourier modes? And can we have Fourier modes that are picky? And is it a problem? So just the first simple example where you have this graph here, and I will modify this weight from zero to two and see what happens to the eigenvalues and eigenvector of the Laplacian, of the graph Laplacian. So if W is zero, they're just it's disconnected. You have two graphs, in fact. And for the when you have that, you have an eigenvalue zero, which is degenerated. You have two cases where you have for this graph and this graph. And then when you increase the weight, you create a connection, then it will influence all the eigenvalues because they will all increase. So, okay, it has an impact on all the eigenvalues, but it has also an interesting impact on the eigenvectors here. So I just plot the Fiedler vector, the one that changed sign once on the graph. And these are the points here, and these are the values. Okay, so if you look at W, the range one, the W equal one, that means just a connection the same as these ones. You get this curve, which just, okay, change sign. And increase nicely. If you increase the weight here to five, then what you see is that there is a small change. Why? Because if the weight is stronger, it's cost a lot to change the value between here and here because you multiply by the weight. So what happens is that there is a change which is much smaller. Okay. And what happens when you have W, which is small, then it costs almost nothing to change the value here. And what does the feedler vector? It just suddenly jumped from one value to another one. It just changed sign here, in fact. And then it is a bit almost constant on the other side. So now you start to see that this case, it starts to be picky somewhere. So it starts to be localized on some nodes. And it doesn't behave at all like a cosine. And this is because you have some irregularity, okay? Another example is this one, which is called the comet graph. So you have a head and a tail. And if you look at the eigenvectors, the first one is a feedler vector in here. Then the second, third, and fourth are here, and the five, six, and seven are here. And what you see is that these vectors, they have zero value on the tail. So four, five, six, seven are these nodes. So they have zero value, and they have values here. So they start to be concentrated in one part of the graph. And the other eigenvector, they are constant, not zero, but close to on this part, and have a variation on this part. So you start to see that these Fourier modes or graph Fourier modes, they are not really like in the standard case. Now they start to concentrate in some part of the graph because of irregularities. So what, okay, good. But now I want just to make an intuitive connection with let's say machine learning. So if you have the first case where you have a graph, which is very weakly connected, like this node and that are disconnected, then you don't have a lot of neighbors. You cannot just deduce a value from one node from these neighbors because it's not connected. And so machine learning cannot make use of the graph because it's not enough connected. And you see that with signal processing on graph, because you see that the eigenvector of the Laplacian, they start to localize and breach this uncertainty principle. And same thing for us, because if you have L, then you have one node, which is connected to many nodes. So if you do want to do machine learning also, if it's just connected to many nodes, then you are doing an average. And most of the time, some of the nodes, they are not really related, even if they are connected. So that's quite bad to guess something about the node. And same with the small world where you have, imagine you have a network where everything is connected to everything, then it's not an interesting information from the graph point of view, because if you just look at, find a pattern, then everything is connected to everything. So you cannot have a complex pattern. And just to make this point even more important, imagine you want to do something similar to image classification. You want to detect some patterns on images. So you imagine you want to make a distinction between cat and dogs, for example. Then you have like this large convolution network that just learn to see some pattern that look like a dog and a cat and make the difference. So if you take an image of a dog or a cat on a sphere, that's okay, that will work still. If you start to do that on like a complex manifold, then maybe if the cat or the dog are close to something that are very irregular, like tails, they'll be really deformed. It will be difficult maybe to find the correct pattern. And same for this, if it start to be very irregular connected. But imagine now that you want to put this image on this kind of graph, social network, very highly connected, then you cannot have a complex pattern because it's a small world. So in just a few steps, you can reach any node of the graph from any starting point. So you cannot have a pattern where you have sharp edge that are looking like, I don't know, the head of a dog or the tail or anything. And even worse also for a graph network, which is very highly connected. So if you take this graph convolution network, you cannot have many layers because, I mean, they will be useless because they are not so complicated. Cannot be, cannot exist too many, too complicated pattern on this. And even most of the patterns that you encounter in this kind of graph, there are some sort of blobs, because of course, the nodes that are connected, that means they share some similarities. So if one node here has a value, then the node connected will have a value which is close. So this will be like a ball, and you don't have much sharp edges between nodes that are connected. Okay. So you have to be, the message is that you have to be careful when you use this kind of graph neural network or machine learning on graphs because of the graph, and you have to select the graph. You maybe have to change the graph and to adapt it so that it's not like a big airy ball, very well connected, or something completely disconnected. And there are interesting questions of now of why, how you can change the graph to make it more meaningful when you combine it to the data for the classification task or whatever task. So very good. Was faster than I expected. So now we have plenty of time for question. I will be happy to answer.